streams unite to flow. Africa stands proud and tall. As we learn, we trust, we know God is in control. Bless us, O Lord, guide us with grace. May North West be blessed always. Bless us, O Lord, see those who need. Oris te jovan semporena, see those bless us, O
Seën ons, o Heer. Wat 'n kosbare woorde. En die gedeelte wat ek vanaand vir ons wil lees, sluit spesifiek daarby aan. Seën ons, o Heer. Want die Here Jesus was hier tot seën van 'n vrou wat het bitter nodig gehad het. Die woord compassion, Karen het my daarby uitgebring. So ek gaan nie vanaand so sterk op die bewyse klem lê nie, maar die mooie Afrikaans daarvoor, dink ek, is deernis. Regtige deernis. Die bekende gedeelte uit Johannes 8. Maar Jesus het na die Olyfberg gegaan. En vroeg in die môre het hy weer in die tempel gegaan en al die mense het na hom gekom. En hy het gaan sit en hulle geleer. So hier is die Here besig om die mense te leer. Die mense hoor die woord van die Here. Hulle wil verstaan. Hulle is vastgevang in 'n wettiese soort godsdiens van moets en moenies, ons noem het in die ethiek, kasuïstiek. Dit is 'n hele klomp reels van wat hulle alles moet navolg. En hier kom iemand en sê, maar het gaan oor die hart van sake, dit gaan oor ware omgee, so waarheid is daar maar regte omgee, regte deernis. En dan word dit gekonfronteer. En die skrifgeleerders en die fariseers het 'n vrou wat in egbreuk betrap was, na hom gebring. En toe hulle haar tussen hulle in laat staan, het sê hulle vir hom, Meester, hierdie vrou is op 'n daad van egbreuk betrap. Moses het ons in die wet bevel gegee om sulke vroue te stenig, maar u, wat sê u? Met ander woorde, dit het hier nie om die vrou gegaan nie. Dit het gegaan oor u, wat sê u? Hierdie was 'n manier om die Here so ver te kry om iets te sê wat hom of kan gaan verklaar by die Romeinse owerheid. Hy sê stenig hierdie vrou of vir die Jode gaan sê, maar hy luister nie na die wet van Moses nie. Hy sê moet haar nie stenig nie. So hulle het gedink hulle het hier iets baie slims reg gekry. Maar die agtergrond hiervan is eintlik meer skrikwekkend. Want as mens gaan kyk na die wet van Moses, is daar net een keer wat iemand gestenig moet word. Daar's ander strawwe, maar steniging is as 'n meisie die eerste keer verloof is en dan op 'n seksuele daad betrap word en deur twee getuies gesien is dat sy dit doen. So ons kan dink hoe moeilik dit moet wees. Punt 1. Hierdie meisie was tussen 14 en 16, maar dis die ouderdom wat hulle daardie tyd getrou het. Punt 2. Hulle het duidelik 'n lokval gestel, want hulle bring nie die man saam nie, hoe het sy alleen oorspel gepleeg. Hulle bring nie die man saam nie, hulle bring haar saam. En dit was so uitgewerk, dat hulle haar presies kan vang daarmee. Nie omdat hulle enigszins vir haar omgegee het nie, maar hulle wou die Here op 'n manier uit die pad uitkry. Want hy pas nie in by hulle dwinglandy en die manier wat hulle mense beheer nie. Hy pas nie in by een soort godsdienst wat ons vandag nog in die Midde-Ooste kry, van baie strenge reëls en maniere van doen nie. En daarom, ek dink ons wat veral in 'n Christelike omgewing groot word, besef nie hoe radikaal die Here se optrede was. Dit was die manier van doen. Die godsdienst in daardie omgeving het allemaal so gewerk. Klomp reels wat jy moet nakom, en dan het jy 'n kans om 'n goeie verhouding met God te mag hê. En wat doen die Here dan? Ons kan dink hoe verskrik hierdie meisie was. Hy is besig hier om 'n klomp mense te leer. Sy is van Jerusalem, so baie van hulle ken haar. Hier staan sy, kom ons sê 15-jarige meisie. Hierdie mense dan geen deernis nie. Maar die Here het deernis. En hy wys dit op 'n kosbare manier. Deur hulle nie te antwoord nie. Wat doen hy? En dit het hulle gesê om hom te versoek, sodat hulle iets kon hê om hom te beskuldig. Maar Jesus het neergebuk en met die vinger op die grond geskrywe. Wat gebeur met iets wat ek op die grond skryf? Het verdwyn. Dinge wat ons publiseer, glo ons gaan nie verdwyn nie. Dit gaan 'n invloed hê op mense. Dis tog hoekom ons die navorsing en die werk doen. Maar iets wat ek in die grond skryf is soos 'n sandkasteel, dit verdwyn. En dis waarmee hierdie mense besig is. Hulle is besig met beselagtighede. Maar toe hulle aanhou om hom te vra, het hy hom opgerig, so hy het letterlik opgestaan, hy het na hulle gekyk en hy het vir hulle gesê, laat die een van julle wat sonder sonde is, die eerste klip op haar gooi. En hy het weer neergebuk en op die grond geskrywe. Mens kan sê, 'n briljante antwoord om uit die moeilikheid te kom, nee, 'n geweldige antwoord om hierdie mense aan te spreek. Wie's jy? Jy wat soveel genade ontvang, jy wat self soveel deernis ontvang, om nou so hard te wees en sogenaamd die reëls te probeer uitvoer. En dan die geweldige impak wat dit gemaak het. En dit is deel van 'n studie waarmee ek besig is, die hele kwessie van ons gewete. Dat die Here dit vir ons gegee dat ons 'n gewete kan hê. Dat ons nie maar net daar is om te oorleef en ek kan op ander trappie, maar dat dinge my aanspreek. Selfs dinge wat ek nie wil doen nie, dit sal ek doen. En in julle omgewing van die gesondheidswêreld, doen julle baie keer en offer julle geweldig op, wat eintlik teen julle eie voordeel is. Partykeer sien mense hoe moeg mense is, en hoe uitgeput hulle is, en in hierdie coronatijd het mense heel wat daarvan gelees. Ons gesondheidswerkers, ons mense wat in hierdie hele wêreld werk. Maar hoe kan doen hulle dit? Oor daardie gewete. Daardie iets wat die Here elke mens gegee het om regtig om te gee. En daarom so hartseer as mens met psigopate te doen het, dat hierdie gewete so afgestomp is. Ja, hulle weet nog wat reg en verkeerd is, want as jy hulle uitvang, dan weet hulle van die gewete. Maar dat dit so afgestomp is. Hoorie. En toe hulle dit hoor, het hulle deur hulle gewete bestraf, een vir een weggegaan, van die oudste af, tot die laaste toe. Hier sit al hierdie mense en kyk, al die aanklaers is weg, in hierdie middel is het nog net die vrou en die Here Jesus. Jesus het alleen agtergebly en die vrou wat daar tussen hulle ingestaan het. En toe Jesus hom oprig en niemand sien, behalwe die vrou nie, sê vir haar, vrou, waar is daar die beskuldigers van jou? Het niemand jou veroordeel nie? Hoor ons die absolute meegevoel, die deernis in daardie woorde. Jy is uitgevang, jy, allemaal in die stad, gaan nou weet wie is jy. Het niemand van al daardie belangrike mense, het niemand vir hulle kon bly staan nie, is hulle allemaal ook sondaars. Kyk hoe geweldig sit die Here haar weer, eintlik terug om te kan mens wees, soos wat sy bedoel is om te wees. Waar is daardie beskuldigers? Het niemand jou veroordeel nie? En sy antwoord, niemand nie, Here. En Jesus sê vir haar, ek veroordeel jou ook nie. Wie kon die eerste klip gooi? Hy, die Here Jesus. Want hy was sonder enige sonde. Maar ek veroordeel jou ook nie. Gaan heen en sondig nie meer nie. En nou is het zo interessant als mens die woord sonde wat hier gebruikt wordt in die Grieks nagaan. Dan is het niet enige woord sonde nie, specifieke woord sonde wat aansluit bij die Oud Testament wat betekent om jou doel te mis. So hy sê vir haar eintlik gaan en moet nie jou doel mis nie. Kostbare deernis. Soveel deernis dat hy later aan die kruis terwyl mense hom spot kon sê, Vader vergeef hulle, hulle weet nie wat hulle doen nie. En wanneer ons met deernis lewe, wanneer ons regtig omgee vir mense, dan leef ons ietsie daarvan uit. Kom ons bid saam. Ons Heer en Hemelse Vader, ons dank en ons loof en ons prijs U, dat ons nie net hier een klomp reels moes nagekom het om uiteindelik een of ander posisie voor U te kry nie. Maar dat U wat ons geskep het, ons met deernis geskep het, ons met omgee geskep het, ja, met reg en geregtigheid en waarheid, maar om het op so'n wyse oor te dra, soos wat ons ook hier by ons Here Jesus leer ken. Ons dankie Here vir soveel mense wat vanavond hier saam is, wat in 'n omgee wêreld lewe, wat ander leer, studente, en ook deur die werk wat hulle doen, om werkelijk omgee te wys. En ons dankie ook vir haar, wat vanavond hier die besonderse toekenning kry. Ons dankie Here, dat U ook deur vir Karen deur haar lewe vasgehou het, saam met Frans, saam met die kinders, om uiteindelik ook omgee mense te mag wees. Ons dankie vir die liefde vir ons. Ons dankie dat U ons harte verander, om met deernis te mag lewe. Amen.
Goeienavond, dames en heren, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Avi Kotse, Executive Dean of the Faculty of Health Sciences, and it's really an honor to do the welcoming at this inauguration ceremony of Prof. Karen Mini, our Research Director for Quality in Nursing and Midwifery in the Faculty of Health Sciences at the Northwest University Potchefstroom campus. A special word of welcome to Prof. Linda du Plessis, sitting right in front of me here, our Vice Principal and Deputy Vice Chancellor of NWU, who's also our main functionary for the evening. It is really an honor, Prof. Linda, to have you here, and we deeply appreciate your support, your loyalty, your dedication, and friendship to this faculty and its staff members. Welcome also to Prof. Henk Stoker, who has opened the ceremony with scripture reading and prayer, and who will close also with a prayer for us today. And then also a word of welcome to other members of the University Management Committee and Senior Management Committee who will follow the ceremony afterwards via virtual access. Karen, if I'm correct, there's also a live streaming tonight, so there's a lot of other colleagues who are probably also at the moment listening. I also welcome the members of the Faculty Management Committee of the Faculty of Health Sciences, Prof. Janetta du Plessis sitting in the middle here, our Deputy Dean Research and Innovation in the Faculty of Health Sciences. Our Deputy Dean Teaching and Learning, Prof. Grita Hanekom, has asked me specifically to apologize tonight as she cannot be here since she has undergone an operation today and will be in hospital for a couple of days and on sick leave then for a while. Also, just recently, the School Director of Nursing, Dr. Molakodi Matsapane, and his colleagues who were on their way to Potchefstroom. Their rental car was delivered very late. And it was just impossible for them to get in that short time to Potchefstroom. So we advised them to rather stay and to follow the procedures via virtual means. Then welcome to Dr. Elsie Borman, our deputy school director of the School of Nursing Sciences here on the Potchefstroom campus. Welcome, Elsie. We are proud of your school. I think it's your third candidate this year who have an inauguration ceremony. So nursing is getting the prize for most inaugurations this year. Prof. Petra Bester, the director of Africa Unit for Transdisciplinary Health Research in the faculty and also a community nurse, but working very transdisciplinary, still by training a nurse. Prof. Marty Libbe, director of a niche area for medicine usage in South Africa in the faculty. Prof. Hanley Moss, the director of a physical activity, sport and recreation sciences group, research group in the Faculty of Health Sciences, Prof. Johan du Plessis, Director of Occupational Hygiene and Health Research Initiative in the Faculty of Health Sciences. Then a special word of welcome. She's sitting so silently there at the back. Our previous dean, Prof. Marleen Viljoen, also a nurse by training who has been a legacy for us, second dean of a faculty, and who has had a major impact on us, Prof. Marleen. We are so glad that you are able to join us. It's the second one that you join us this year. The other nursing one was of emerentia was done in several parts and things, but thank you for still coming to these events of a faculty. We cannot tell you how much we appreciate that and how dear it is for us that you still keep us in your heart, and we will can assure you that you are always and every day also in our hearts. Then a special word of welcome also to Prof. Karen's colleagues, all our collega's in the school, in ook in Mafeking, ander staff, en personeellede op campus saam met wie sy werk, en dan ook die nagraadse studente van nursing wat van die school vir verpleegkunde wat vanavond teenwoordig kan wees. Dan een speciale woord van welkom aan die nabij mense van Prof. Karen, haar familie en haar vriende. In die eerste plek haar eggenoot Dr. Frans Minnie, haar seun François Minnie, haar dochter en skoonseun, Carissa en Jacques Snyman, haar sister en haar eggenoot, Rachel en Philip Strydom, haar sister Herma Schulze, haar oom en sy vrou, mense wat geen bekendstelling nodig het hierso nie, oom Gideon en tannie Petra Kaal, waar sit hulle? Daar sit hulle daar achter, baie welkom, oom Gideon, tannie Petra, ek ken julle nou ook baie goed, ook van die kerk af, en julle is ook in die ware sin van die woord legendes met hierdie prachtige wondkliniek wat julle bedryf, tannie Petra, vooral jy, wat een besonderse diens in die gemeenskap lever, so baie welkom ook aan julle. It now gives me great pleasure to introduce to you our special guest of the evening, Prof. Karen Minnie, and I request that she join me for introducing her. Prof. Karen, you are most welcome to come and stand just next to us and to ensure that you will be in all the camera shots. Is it fine if she stands here? Everybody has her. So it's fine. Right. Karen Minnie was born as the oldest of three daughters of Otto and Rina Kaal. She grew up in Potchefstroom and matriculated at Potchefstroom Gymnasium. She graduated with her primary degree in nursing science, that was at that time the Baccalaureus Art et Science, cum laude at the former Potchefstroom University, my apologies for Christian Higher Education in 1985. Karen also obtained an honors degree in psychology the following year. Frans and Karen Minnie was married in 1982 and have three children, Francois, Otto, and Carissa, of which one son has unfortunately passed away a couple of years back. After working for 18 years as a registered nurse and midwife in public and private hospitals, as well as in primary health care and private practice, she was appointed as midwifery lecturer at the former Potchefstroom University for Christian Higher Education in 2000. She obtained her Magister Curationis degree in Obstetric and Neonatal Nursing, cum laude, in 2003, and her PhD in 2007. She was promoted to senior lecturer in 2005, to associate professor in 2013, and to professor in 2020. Karen is currently serving her second term as director of NUMIC, the research focus area affiliated to the School of Nursing, serving both campuses, Potchefstroom and Mafeking, where there's a School of Nursing, focusing on research to advance nursing and midwifery. Karen has immense gratitude for the opportunities granted to her. She was awarded a postdoctoral grant by the International Network for Doctoral Education in Nursing, or INDEN, and Sigma Theta Tau International, and spent 3 months in Edmonton at the University of Alberta, Canada, with Prof. Greta Cummings. She was also fortunate to be invited to participate in 2 separate European cost actions as a country lead for South Africa. Through this collaboration, led by Prof. Sue Down, she was able to build a strong international network. Karen was also part of the first cohort of Plume fellows benefiting from the project of Fundisa, that's a nursing association in South Africa, and the National Research Foundation to facilitate focused research programs. 24 master's degree students and 2 PhD degree students completed their studies under Karen's supervision, while 6 masters and another 4 PhD students are in process with their studies. She has published more than 20 articles in accredited academic journals and published 7 book chapters. In terms of presentations, she presented more than 40 posters, papers, or workshops at international and national peer-reviewed conferences. She's also regularly invited to present on evidence-based practice, conducting systemic reviews, and other topics. Karen has received recognition for her scholarly work. She was inducted into the Fundisa Hall of Fame for Research Excellence in Nursing on 22 July 2016. She was also nominated and inducted as Fellow of Academy for Nursing of South Africa, or ANSA. In 2018, she was also rated as an established scientist by the National Research Foundation in the category C2. So Karen is a passionate midwife and supporter of evidence-based practice. She loves working with mothers, babies, and students. But this is not all. This is actually a very special evening tonight because Karen will have to do a follow-up inauguration lecturer very soon. And I do not know a lot of professors who has to do that. For those who don't know, Karen will join the University of the Western Cape in February next year, Karen. It's an early type of moving for their retirement place, where I know they want to go and retire, as the children are also there, and Frans is also already doing some work in that environment. So Karen, I trust that you're gonna keep this work and use it probably also at the University of the Western Cape. And from my side, I just want to wish you also good luck with your future there. It's with a sad heart that we would see you leaving us, but we also know that you've got only a couple of years left as an academic and an early move to get your retirement things in place. We are all the way with you. So, colleagues, you will all agree that this is truly a remarkable academic record and an excellent achievement that Prof. Karen Minnie has achieved over many years. And with this, ladies and gentlemen, we will now proceed to hand over the academic wear to Prof. Karen Minnie and invite her to deliver her inaugurational lecture with the title Evidence and Compassion in Maternity Care. Congratulations from my side, Karen, and also from the faculty side, and enjoy your presentation.
Good evening. I'm really privileged and I really am so overwhelmed about you attending and sharing I hope to share my passion for my research area and my life up to now as academic with you all. I also acknowledge the students and colleagues and friends that's not able to be here, that all we've sent them the link, so hi. I hope you feel that you're here also. So I know it's a something that only few people are privileged to reach this stage of their career, and so I am really so privileged to have you all with me. So my lecture then, we hope it works. Okay. So I'm starting with an overview. So I'm talk just a brief section on my journey of my academic career up to now. Then I'm talking specifically about maternity care and quality maternity care, midwifery as component of quality midwifery care, maternity care, and then a bit more about midwifery itself, and then a bit about my future plans. So my journey, a bit of reflection. As you've heard, I've studied nursing and midwifery and psychology, so that was my background. And then while I was having my children and raising them, I was always with one foot in practice also, working as community nurse, working as midwife, and doing community work as a breastfeeding counselor. It's also a passion of mine. And then working in private hospital, primary health care. And then, as Prof. Avi also mentioned, 2000, I joined the then PU for CHE, and I started my academic career. And then, since that time, I've taught midwifery, and I also got my specialist training or education as advanced midwife, and then also taught the advanced midwifery program. And then in the meantime also obtained my master's and PhD and started supervising students and got more and more involved with research and eventually also in management. So I've got lots of experience in this place, so it will be with a sad heart that I leave it, but I know I've done my bit and I hope I will leave something worthwhile behind also. So in 2003, I did my master's, and it was on the choice of baby feeding mode within the HIV epidemic, specifically health education implications. And after that master's, as you can see, it was 2003, so it was before we were having ARVs. So at that stage, it made a huge difference in things like mother-to-child transmission, that baby feeding mode, breastfeeding or bottle feeding or formula feeding. So that was quite a relevant topic at that stage. But during my this study, I realized that one need to know the HIV status of someone to be able to give health education, a relevant health education. So my PhD followed from that, and I wanted to know what would be the best way to counsel women to let their status be known. And that's why I developed in best practice guidelines for counseling for HIV testing. But then it was in the end, after my PhD, my passion was not HIV anymore. But during this journey, were introduced to evidence-based practice, systematic reviews, and then the whole methodology about developing best practice guidelines. And that was an eye-opener for me, and it really, the rest of my career very much followed on that. So, as Prof. Avi also mentioned, then when I had the opportunity to do my postdoc in Canada, I developed a research program there, CREAM. It was all about contextualizing research to advance midwifery, because after my PhD, I realized again, but there was things that was quite clear from the evidence, this is the best way to do things. But then I realized, it's not going to work in this context. So the whole thing about how to integrate or adapt evidence also to be practical in practice and in a specific context was sparkled there, and so I've did a lot of studies and research on implementation science or knowledge to action, the leaders in that field, and also as mentioned, presented workshops on this, and attended and delivered presentations at conferences, so that was my new field of interest then also. And then after my NRF rating I got then, when I started to more focus more into promotion of kind of compassionate care and maternity care. But as I will show you during my presentation, this is one thing flowing from the other, and it was a kind of logical extension of my original interest. So if we talk then about what is maternity care specific, and there's lots of definitions and one can get very technical about it, but for me it means this care of the mother-baby diet during pregnancy, childbirth, and the first few months. So for me, maternal care also influenced the neonate or the fetus, because what happens with the mother, they're a unit for now. We talk about there's a fourth trimester of pregnancy, because at that stage my daughter is still in that, but it's as if she's still pregnant with a baby. So whatever happens with the mum happens with the baby too. So if then we talk about specifically quality maternity care, when through the decades, so in the 80s and the 90s, it was all about prevention of maternal mortality and morbidity. Everything was focused on that on global level, the WHO and organizations like that. And then they realized that, okay, we can, the people must have access to skilled providers. And it's during that stage that things like traditional birth attendants, and they were part of the community for hundreds of thousands of years, but then they were sidestepped and it needed to be a professional, skilled person. And then eventually it ran through the world, and then they realized, but we still have maternal mortality and the numbers don't really come down. And then the focus moved to quality. But then I realized again, the way I understood quality is that we need to do in-service training. We need to skill people that they can handle postpartum hemorrhage, that they can handle things like pre-eclampsia. But the whole issue of what the mother's side of the story and patients' rights and the perception of care from her side were not really part of the picture. So eventually, there were some signs that it started coming through. So in 2010, there was a maternal health series in the Lancet, I think it's 2016. But then they realized there's two huge issues that, in a sense, opposing one another, but both have a huge influence on quality maternity care. Too little too late and too much too soon. So too little too late is usually in places where there's inadequate resources, the standard of care is not really evidence-based or below what it's supposed to be. Or you all know about people, we read it in the newspaper, things like ambulances not turning up or people not even getting the care that they're supposed to get. And all of this happens right through the world, but more often in low-income countries. And that lead to high mortality and morbidity, as one can expect it. But there's also the opposite of that, and that is too much too soon. And that is overuse and routine use of medicalization that's not really... And I think we all know that that's what happened in the private sector also, things that's happening just because it's available, not necessarily because it's the best for this specific woman in this condition or in this situation in her life. So it's about the unnecessary use of non-evidence-based interventions or things that can be life-saving, like an induction that would save a baby's life or a cesarean section, but now it's being used routinely and eventually it also have negative effects. So this too much too soon can cause harm and can definitely lead to increased cost. And we'll come to that a bit later, but it contributes to disrespect and abuse. So both of these are not nice to have. It's threats. And then, unfortunately, we know South Africa have a foot in both sides. So we've got both of these. We've got too little too late, and we've got too much too soon. So both of this, one needs to be aware that it's happening and that it's maybe not so openly, but it's underlying. So if we come to the WHO, they've, I think it was also about 2016, I don't see my reference here now, but it's at that stage they realized that quality of care, as I've just mentioned previously, it was all about skill uplifting and workshops, and you need to get the health personnel better educated. And for the first time then they realized, but it's not just about the provision of care, it's also about the experience of care. So the provision is about this evidence-based practice and management of complications, and also then things like actionable information system and a good functional referral system, but it's also about effective communication, about respect and preservation of dignity, and also emotional support. This is also part of quality. So it was quite a diversion of the WHO of thinking up to that stage. And then there was specifically midwifery, also came to the fore in this time, because there was also again a groundwork a series in Lancet specifically with midwifery. And I was part of a device where very much, you know, we're interventions as that is a bit of a, it's not a nice word for a midwife to use. And then we started seeing midwifery as the intervention. So the whole thing that how midwifery itself can make a difference. So we said at that stage, I say midwifery can definitely contribute to quality maternity care. And it does, so it's about the skilled, knowledgeable, compassionate care for childbearing women, newborn infants, and families across the continuum through pre-pregnancy, pregnancy, birth, postpartum, and in the early weeks of life. And then for this core characteristics of this midwife, then is the optimizing normal, biological, physiological, psychological, social, and cultural process of reproduction and early life. So it's very much about protecting what would normally happen or physiologically. It's about timely prevention and then management of complications. It's about working together with others. So it's not necessarily silo, and then respecting women's individual circumstances and views and working in partnership with the woman to strengthen her own capacity in the end. It's still not, she's not supposed to be dependent on the health system, so it's all about uplifting herself also. So this midwifery series, then they showed that if there's it's associated with efficient use of resources. So if there's midwives, it can be life-saving, and it will also be cost-saving in the end, and with improved outcomes. So, but then there's some conditions of the that the midwives would need to meet. So, and they definitely, as I said, they need to work together in a team with sufficient resources. Otherwise, it's also not really going to work. So, as I understand it, or as the part of the midwifery world, is the midwife is really the specialist in physiological childbirth. And there's also there's a midwifery language, so we can talk about normal, we can talk about a vaginal childbirth, but it's very much about the physiological also, and it's protecting the physiological way. And then another interesting midwife, the English word, in a sense, is also from the Netherlands, vroedvrouw, maar the midwife is, I think it was, I say the old English, it's with women. So the mid is met. So it's all about this working with women. So it's providing care and support, physical, psychological, emotional, and spiritual way. So a midwife has a different philosophy than a medical background. So I'll come back to that in a while. So another core concept of midwifery is then woman-centered care. It's about what women want. And we're very keen that we can't do things just because it's prescribed by the doctor or by the hospital or by the health service or the health department. So Brown et al. Did a systematic review of lots of other qualitative studies on this topic, and the conclusions was that what mattered to most women is a positive experience that fulfilled or exceeded her prior personal and social-cultural beliefs and expectations. So this include giving birth to a healthy baby in a clinically and psychological safe environment with practical and emotional support from a birth companions and competent reassuring kind clinical staff. But I'm sure you've all heard that even if someone had a very traumatic experience, they will say, don't worry, the baby is healthy. But there's also things like post-traumatic stress, and that's coming to the fourth now, that can have long-term effects. But in a sense, for many years, it's okay, you've got a healthy baby, so just keep quiet about the rest. So it's not woman-centered then. So although most women wanted a physiological birth, labor and birth, they also acknowledged that things can go wrong, and sometimes they must go with the flow. And then so there's women that prefer interventions, and then it's also okay. But even in that situation, they want to retain a sense of personal achievement and control through active decision making. So even if that's a choice, it must still be a positive experience for her. So then again, down with the Byron did a qualitative study on what to women and other midwives think is the, what makes a good midwife, what makes an exceptional midwife. And then in the end, it worked through to these three main domains, on a cognitive, psychomotor, and affective domains. And then I, for the rest of my lecture, I concentrate on this of the cognitive as the head, the psychomotor as the hands, and then the affective as the heart. So if then we come to the hand is then competent in various domains, and it's, as we said, it can start even pre-pregnancy, but during pregnancy, during birth, and with the baby. So on different levels, midwife will use her hands. Also, so sometimes to just give support. It's also important use, and then I've included the infection control. So then the problem is there's not enough hands. So every 4 years there's a State of the World Midwifery Report. The 21 one was launched a bit earlier this year, and according to that, at this stage we meet the workers working in this field of, they call it sexual, reproductive, maternal, newborn, and adolescent health. It's a long section of work, but they say about 75% of the need of the world is currently fulfilled. But even then, in the current rate that midwives and other health professionals increase, even in 2030, we will still not meet what we are supposed. They say they will probably rise to about, I think, you know, I didn't even include it, but it's about 80%. So it didn't really make a difference, even we will still be short. So there's a lot of midwives that need it through the world. But interesting enough, South Africa is not part of the statistics. Why? And then I went to look at the statutory body, South African Nursing Council, and the thing is, in South Africa, I think maybe Dr. Carl will remember previous years, a very long time ago, there was people that was just midwives. They got green epaulets, and they were not nurses, they were midwives. And then during the 80s, I think that programs were all stopped, and for everyone, doesn't mind what route you follow, but you will have to be a nurse and eventually be a midwife. And there was the rationale behind that was that the world, or South Africa specifically, need primary health care. It's the focus of our research. So if they want to, if they need to place someone at a primary health care clinic, for example, they need to be able to handle all the midwifery cases and the geriatric patients and the TB patients and everything. They must be comprehensively trained. Now, I think we've realized in the meantime that maybe it's not really realistic. So everything's, the quality of everything was just a bit downgraded in that process. But but it's very deeply through the health system and then in South African Nursing Council, midwifery is not seen as an independent career as in the rest of the world. And there's no direct entry programs in South Africa, and it's also not recognized by the Nursing Council. So currently I've looked at the statistics for people that were trained in midwifery, and it's not so bad, 174,000 in 2020. However, these people are all nurses first, and also midwives. So there's no way that we can see how many work as nurses or midwives, how many of them consider themselves midwives. And that's why our statistics are not included in that State of the World Midwifery Report. Maybe I can just mention here, akasheer, I've got an akasheer here of one of my students, but that's the male midwife. And I prefer calling them male midwives as we've seen what the word midwife means. It's not about a female. It's about someone with women. So it can be a male midwife, although you will have to explain it every time. But that would be a good thing to explain it every time because more people become aware of the meaning of that. So if we then look more to in the situation of South Africa, differences, our training mostly, it can be part, I must say the whole training of nursing is in the transition phase, but usually it's a four-year program, either a diploma or a degree. We're just going to degrees now, but then they need, in this period, there's about, say, 18 months that they also do midwifery, but they do a whole lot of other subjects also. Or they do a shorter, or they do just a three-year nursing program, and then on top of that, they do another midwifery program. But we're not on the level of the rest of the world. For example, in South Africa, then, in order to be registered as a midwife, you need to do 15 deliveries, or as I would love to say it, you need to attend 50 births, because it's a woman that births. I don't think it's something that you do to her. But then, for the rest of the world, it's different, and they have more time just concentrating, going deeper into midwifery itself, and then other countries, for example, the UK, Australia, Kenya, Malawi, all require at least 50 births that a woman, that a midwife need to attend before she's registered. And then I midwives, even people that completed their training with us and worked for 20 years as a midwife, they need to go and retrain when they come to UK because they don't recognize our training as up to scratch. So that's very sad, but it's true. But it's also like in every, for the last 20 years, I've had that fight also, but in the hospital, they also see someone working in a maternity unit or in a theater or in a medical ward, and then every 3 months, now, okay, let's change around. So now, even if you've got a master's degree in midwifery, you're probably going to be placed in another specialization again because you're a nurse. So it's again, but it's from the top that's the attitude. And then there's independent midwives, but they've also got their challenges. I'm sure you know of in the last year or what, there's court cases, and then if there's one bad apple, all the others also are painted with the same brush, and they all struggle because of one midwife that probably didn't act as he was supposed to do. So then other challenges, maybe I can just quickly go through this bit, but in the UK they've also got problems, and they have an aging midwifery group, and then they had a huge survey now about all the acting all the practicing midwives from the Royal College of Midwifery in the UK, and they've realized that half of them want to leave practice because of understaffing. They say they can't deliver the quality of care they would love to do, and then pay. But and then, as I've mentioned, they try to get midwives from other places of the world to fill up their numbers, but even the South Africans that we're already too little can't really go and work there, so we're in a bit stuck there. And then just recently, Friday, 19th of November, Minister Joe Patla had to answer it at the Portfolio Committee for Health in Parliament. They asked him questions about the annual report of the National Department of Health. And he had to acknowledge that although there's 73,000 posts for professional nurses -net, or that's also midwives, nearly 10,000 of that post are vacant. And the problem is they stay vacant. They're not filled because they have different reasons, but very often they will call it budget limitations, but we know that budget limitations can also be because of malmanagement or corruptions and all of that. So on paper, it doesn't look too bad. But in reality, posts stay vacant for years, and there's chronic understaffing of maternity services. So one of these practices that's evidence-based practice, that's to do with hands and brain, is then we talk about evidence-based, where we, whatever you do, have a good evidence for it. Where was it now? Sorry, now I think I get my verloor. Okay, so with regard to evidence-based practice, that's where we're supposed to be. And now it's about having looking for the best evidence available. So that can be research evidence if there's research evidence about a specific practice, but it can also be there's an overlap that it's not just about the evidence, but it. Research evidence, it's also about clinical expertise and about the patient. And then also what after my PhD, I've realized that the context must also be part of this. It's not just the three main components, it's happening in a context, as I've explained. So the official definition of patients, but as I say, we would like to talk about women because we don't see them necessarily as ill. So part of this then also, I've come to know this model knowledge to action process of Graham et al. And there we see the triangle in the middle. It's about the top one is about primary research. And that's very often what the master student do. And then there's knowledge synthesis, where a lot of different small studies are synthesized to get even stronger evidence. And then the last part about knowledge projects is then something like a guideline or a policy or a curriculum where one base it on, or in a sense it's the other way around, but it's from good research and it's from more than one study eventually. So that, and then the outside circle is about implementing it and adapting it and evaluating it. So there's two components where we get the research in the middle and the action on the outside. It steered a lot of my research from the first time I've been introduced to this. So studies that I, my own experience in with systematic reviews as part of my PhD, as I say, it was a long time ago. I think I was the first one that did a systematic review in School of Nursing Science at that stage. And I was crying some days because I couldn't do the critical appraisal. I had to really figure it out how it's supposed to work. And in the meantime, we work with that a lot now. And then I had a student, Wilma ten Hamba-Looy. She did her master's a systematic review. Again, we were on the breastfeeding at that stage, pasteurization of expressed breast milk as an in-home procedure to limit mother-to-child transmission. And then she also did a PhD, and she did a PhD on this outside circle because it was about the spread. She developed, using benefit levers to develop an operational plan for the spread. So she did, took an evidence-based practice, kangaroo mother care, and she investigated the whole issue, why is it working in some places and not in others, and how can one ensure that it's more spread through the whole health system. Then through my involvement in that two European cost project, I've participated in writing a book chapter with Prof. Christa van der Walt, Complexity Involved in Knowledge Transfer. And then now after the second one, I also work with a team of colleagues and we work on more on the transfer to the lay public or to society. So dissemination and enrichment of knowledge about normal birth to bring about a change to society. Then other student projects, some of them were midwifery topics. Demokato Sebopa worked on barriers to research utilization as perceived by midwives in community health centers in Gauteng. Marin Nyoloko did an integrative review about factors affecting breastfeeding in public spaces. And Ralmarie van Rooyen did a study on the use of essential oils for pain relief and anxiety during childbirth, and they followed the systematic review methodology. And then more specific nursing, Tsepiso Moati is, I think he will submit his master's this week, but it's all about comorbidities of child malnutrition in low and medium income countries. He's doing a systematic review, and then there was another one, Marie-Louise Burr, there that worked also on essential oils, but more for relieving symptoms to brain malignancies. And then things that I did more on my own or with colleagues. Through my cost project, I was also introduced to colleagues that were specialists in salatogenesis. That's also positive psychology related to that. But my husband and I had written a chapter in this handbook of them, and it was specifically on academic work in Afrikaans. They had a different languages, and we did a systematic review on what studies were published in Afrikaans about salutogenesis. And then I was involved in this evidence-based practice clinical guidelines in South Africa. So different organizations work together to develop evidence-based practice on neonatal skin care. So then, as I say, we're talking about this hands, mind, and her hand, and then another place where it get together is in continuous support during childbirth. So it's all about companionship, and it's really something that was studied in detail. It does have huge benefits, and it's really, there's no excuse not to have continuous support during childbirth. And I can mention the year I'll just refer to it later, but it was in COVID-19 times. It's not something that's debatable. They need to be a support person for a woman in labor. And The type of support that they can give is emotional support by being there, reassurance, praise, also giving information about the labour progress or about things that you can try for to cope better, comfort measures, touching her, massaging her, bathing. So this person needs to be focused specifically. It's one-to-one support focused on the need of the woman. And also need to be do advocacy or speaking up when needed on behalf of the woman. So this, I've mentioned this, the different aspects of emotional support. And then there was a lot of studies about would be the best person to provide support. And then through systematic reviews, combination of different studies, it was found that it's most beneficial if it's someone that's not really a family. So we know we would like to have the partner, maybe the mother with there, but it's the best type of continuous support is by someone that's just there to give support and she's not really a part of the woman's own network, but she's got some training on how to do it and she's got experience in that. And but even if you can't have a person like that, at least someone from your family and someone that you choose to have there. We all know about stories of people having in something like a birth room and there's someone that they don't have a good relationship with. That cannot work. But and then partners can be there, but they often need support too. So they're not the ideal support person for the mother. Sometimes they also need someone to support them. And so a project that I worked on specifically in continuous support, some of my master students work on how women experience continuous support, then from the midwife side again, what challenges do women or do midwives experience, and then another one on if we know the reality of staff shortages and all of that, what can midwives do to still facilitate continuous support? And then there's two PhD students of me that's currently working on it. So Marieke Bester is busy developing a strategy to facilitate the implementation. So she's working on a whole strategy. And Tombala Kala working on something to strengthen this interpersonal relationships between the midwives, the women, and their companions. So unfortunately, there's lot of bad things also happening. So I disrespect and abuse really come to the front after a very large, I call it a evidence and landscape analysis. And that was published in 2010 and it was called the Exploring Evidence of Disrespect and Abuse in Family-Based Childbirth. And they really opened a ton of worms in this. So there's a lot of research being done up since then about and the forms of this disrespect and abuse with this use of non-evidence-based practice. For example, withholding food because maybe you need to go to theater. It's nonsense. Excessive use of medical intervention. Every woman that gets to 38 weeks, for example, go for an intervention because otherwise it's going to disrupt the, I think, the doctor's golf program. But then there's also things like not asking consent before you do some kind of examination. Verbal abuse, very, very common. Physical abuse, pinching, and there's all kinds of sharp tools involved. And then also discrimination based on certain attributes. We know things like in our country, different, not even racial groups, but cultural groups that's not really from that same facility. They treated differently. Non-confidential care, things not happening behind closed doors, but open for everyone to see. And then just neglect or denial of care, and that's shocking. So another way of predicting this different, defining disrespect and abuse was like this to be right in the middle with the red. It's things that everyone agree now, that's totally out. That's disrespect and abuse. But then there's various degrees from there. Some things that, but the midwife will say, you know, but I'm really just helping her. She's not pushing enough. So I need to talk very hard with her. Or unfortunately, a lot of women accept, but that's part. If I go to hospital, it's going to happen. So there's a bit of a normalization of that bad behavior. And then there's things that That's from the system, that there's not enough beds. We don't have enough staff. It mustn't happen, but it's not, it happened. And then there's things that even from, it's not what we want to do, but it's not up to standard, but it's the reality that we want to live with. And then on the right, on the outside, is things like it's the human rights. And so it's things that's difficult to pinpoint, but it's this whole attitude of disrespect and abuse. So causes very often is because power differences. And then the reality is also the health professionals can be also experience disrespect and abuse. And we think things like gender inequality happens very often. This midwives, we've got a few male midwives, but usually it's in the society women are not as prestigious as men and usually very easy to disregard. And then the midwives themselves also suffer under that. So, and then things like we said, the health system and even the hospital management and all of that, that it's not of a high priority, things like that. So, and in the end, it's respectful care that suffers because of that. But unfortunately, for example, a health facility gets to be known that place, they don't treat you well. Eventually, people don't go to that place, and then we get maternal mortality and even newborns because they don't want to go for services. So it does, in the end, it works through even to that level that was originally just the only way that quality was measured. So, but as midwife or as person, I prefer to build on what works and to have a appreciative approach. So instead of doing research on what's happening in Northwest hospitals and what can the mothers tell me, what can the midwives tell me, I prefer to see what solutions do we have to combat this. So I'm looking more at ways to promote respectful and compassionate maternity care. And then the leaders in this field is the White Ribbon Alliance. They've published this charter, Universal Rights of Childbearing Women, free from harm and ill treatment, having informed consent and even informed refusal. Respect their choices, private and confidential. So I've got 7 universal rights of childbearing women, and then they also published this 5 ways to fix it. So promote it, mobilize communities, integrate it into training, make sure it's part of policy. All of these things eventually to make a difference. And then also, as I say, the WHO is a bit late to come to the party, but eventually 2018 they've published their intrapartum care guidelines, and then for the first time, recommendation number 1 is respectful maternity care, which refers to care organized for and provided to all women in a manner that maintains their dignity, privacy and confidentiality, ensure freedom from harm and mistreatment, and enables informed choice and continuous support during labor, is recommended. So this was now it's WHO first one, so that you need to do the other things also, but this is the first thing that you need to do. So, and then it's also linked into compassion, and there was specifically concept analysis on this, and Henk also referred to it, but it's this recognition of suffering, feeling with, empathy, and then I must do something, thinking about that it's not, and then also acting on it. So there's a continuum of ways of to get to full compassion, and very often it can alleviate suffering through negotiation, knowledge and skills. So there's a whole continuum of practices related to that. So studies that I've done with regarding compassionate maternity care, Krause et al. Published, and myself and Professor Kutsia published with her, the characteristics of compassionate maternity care from the perspective of midwives. Then in another study is currently going, and ready for publication about the characteristics of compassionate care from the perspective of new mothers. And then another master study is currently busy about identifying instruments that we can use to assess. For example, in the end, if we have a strategy to see if there's a before and after. So there's lots of things out there, but to figure out what will be the best way to assess compassionate maternity care. Another a PhD student are busy developing a strategy to promote respect for maternity care, and then we hope also to implement and evaluate it and take it further. Then I've also published a chapter in one of our other colleagues, Professor Emerentia de Plessis, recently edited this book about reflecting on presence in nursing, and then I did the chapter on compassionate maternity care. So presence, she can tell you more about that, but it's also this with women that we do in maternity care, but then on different levels and in different ways, with students and with patients and on different levels. But then, so I, it also linked with my research in that way. So I'm nearly finished. So I've also did implementation of expertise of my study field. So recent things that I've done is that I'm working with the Department of Health, and it's nearly ready to be published, but we've worked on maternity care in COVID-19 times, and then I did a section on respectful maternity care. As I've mentioned, it's non-negotiable. You need to find a way to let it work. And then there's also the wider guidelines for maternal and newborn care that's published every few years, that's used in every clinic and every hospital. I'm also contributing there and working on this chapter on respectful maternity care. But we're still in process with that study. And then just something as a professor and as a leader and from my years, I like to flow back. And then one of the fields is to uplift my colleagues and academics, and then also midwives, new researchers to mentoring and leadership development. I've got experience in two different cohorts of students on a leadership project. And I really live and I believe in this five practices of leadership of coaches and partner. And so if I move to another place of work, I will take this with me. And I'm sure I believe in that it can make a difference. So this is just, I'm concluding with this quote. The greatest joy in the world is to become a mother. The second greatest is to become a midwife. And then for me, the third greatest is to be part of the birth of a new midwife. So this training and being involved, and even if I don't work with mothers directly anymore, I make a difference with every midwife that's next to a mother that's birthing her baby in midwifery language. So I've got references. You're welcome to check them. Okay. So, this is the end of my story. Thank you.
Goeienaand, collega's. Good evening, colleagues. Eerste baie geluk, professor Minnie, met een skitterende intreerede. Ek dink jou passie vir dit wat eerst jou beroep was en toe jou akademiese studieveld geword het, is vir ons allemaal baie duidelik. Ons weet ook, jy het lang gewacht vir hierdie geleentheid. Ek dink het was al 20 maart, en toe moes ons skielik, ek onthou nog die een vrijdag, was ons laaste gradeplegtigheid, toe prof Balia het nog met die besem, met die kap vooraan, en van die maandag af moes ons met die nieuwe regulasies, al die gradeplegtighede en intreerede stop, en het ons nou meer as 'n jaar gevat om het weer te hervat, maar liever laat as nooit. Baie geluk ook aan die fakulteit, professor Awe en professor Janetta. Ek kan eerlik waar sê dat elke jaar as ons akademiese bevorderingsgesprek het, dan is gezondheidswetenskappe se aansoeke rarig van hoogstaande gehalte, en ek dink is 'n geval van sukses kweek sukses. There's one paragraph in the booklet about what is a professor. I think that signifies this event. Full professors denotes distinction, and it's the most senior academic grade an academic can achieve. And it's based on what we have seen tonight, on the individual scholarly achievement, such as postgraduate supervision, publications, academic leadership, and peer recognition. I think all of that was evident tonight. We saw the external recognition Professor Minnie has received. When I checked the stats today, the Northwest University is having 252 NRF-rated researchers. That is from more than 1,560 academics. So one can see that puts you in, it's not something that is easily achievable, and we all know the work that goes into it. Full professors are definitely expected to take on leadership roles and are also involved in managerial tasks. And yes, a professor is involved in service to the institution and the community. And it's clear, Professor Minnie, that your career speaks of this. Also, the number of masters and doctoral students you have supervised is testimony of your leadership in your discipline. We really wish you all of the best in your role as a full professor, even though it might be at another institution. It might be time for us to collaborate also with projects. I don't think this is an exclusive environment, and it's my privilege to hand you something from the Northwest University and also a handmade gift. Colleagues, after this, Professor Stoker will close the ceremony with a prayer, after which we can all stand for the national anthem and remain standing for the procession to leave the venue. Thank you.
Wat 'n kosbare geleentheid. Kom ons bid saam. Ons Here en Hemelse Vader, ons dankie vir dit wat ons saam kon beleef. Kon sien hoe u, een van u kinders, begenadig om op soveel maniere betrokke te wees. Self by ma's en babas te wees en dan ook ander op te lei rondom dit. Navorsing daaroor te doen en uiteindelik met diepe omgee hierdie werk te doen. Kosbaar is dit om saam te kyk hoe u iemand begenadig het en steeds begenadig. En daarom dra ons vir Karen aan u op. Ons bid, Here, dat die werk sal voortgaan. Studente wat sy hier nog het met wie sy gaan saamwerk, nog 'n pad stap. Collega's met wie sy pad sal stap en ook daar waar sy ook 'n nuwe velde moet omploeg. En ons dankie Here dat die deernis en die liefde en die omgee en die erns maak en die waarheid en die studies, dat alles wat hiermee saamgaan, uiteindelik is hoe u ons gemaak het. Ons dankie dat ons u kinders mag wees. In die naam van ons Here Jesus. Amen.